Started for the afternoon session. So we've got six companies today. We're finishing up at 3:00. And first up, we've got Thor Mining. So Nicole Galloway Wyland is going to take us through how Thor is poised for growth as an exploration company focused on mineral discoveries for our future, with an exciting portfolio of projects in Australia and the USA that are highly prospective for lithium, uranium, copper, and gold, with an advanced, here we go, with an advanced tungsten molybdenum, no, moly, yep, copper project ready for development. Nicole Galloway Wyland is here to present the Thor story. Thank you.
Thanks, Ben. Everyone has trouble with the word molybdenum or molybdenite, so all good. Good afternoon, everyone. It's just not going forward. Do I have to present it? Click it. Nothing like having an IT problem at the start of your talk. Well, I'm just waiting for the IT. Just point out, oh, there you go. I was going to say that that's our uranium project over in Colorado. So anyway, we're on to the standard disclaimer. So those of you who don't know Thor Mining, we've got a very exciting portfolio of projects in Australia as well as the US. And I like to say that we're focused on commodities of the future. So commodities in global demand, so uranium, lithium, nickel, copper, gold. So in WA, in Ragged Range project, we're exploring for gold and lithium. We're actually on the ground as we speak, mapping and doing geochem sampling. And I had hoped to announce that we'd have a geophysics crew on the ground, but thanks to COVID, hopefully they'll be on the ground later this week doing some ground geophysics over our nickel Gossan, as well as following up on our gold. We have interest in three copper projects in South Australia, so over 400,000 tons of contained copper, and looking at developing them using in situ recovery. And then in the Northern Territory, we have our advanced shovel-ready project, Molly Hill, as Ben said, exploring for tungsten and molybdenum. And then the one that I'm probably most excited about at the moment is our uranium projects over in the US, so in Utah and Colorado. So just looking at the investment side of things, we're very much poised for growth through discovery as well as advancing or increasing our resources. The projects, as I said, focused on commodities of the future, those in global demand. They're in proven jurisdictions, so we have no sovereign risk. And if anything, with the global sort of situation and geopolitical things, as well as green energy, having a uranium asset in the US is highly beneficial. The areas are prospective, but also relatively underexplored. So again, huge growth potential. Well funded. And what I think probably most importantly is a really strong board and technical team to drive those projects forward with success track record. Just a quick corporate snapshot. We're dual listed, so on the AIM as well as the ASX. Market cap sitting at about 32 million and just under 3 million in the bank. So a good corporate position to move those projects forward and add shareholder wealth. So who is the board? I joined Thor Mining as managing director probably 12 months ago. I'm a geologist with 30 years industry experience. Mark McGough, one of the non-executive directors, is also an experienced geologist. And then over in the U.K., we have Mark Potter, our chair, and Alasdair Clayton, and they bring the finance side of things to the team. So a really good balance through board and management. So what are we currently doing? Well, at our Ragged Range project, as I mentioned, we're on the ground at the moment exploring for lithium. So mapping and geochem work should be there doing the geophysics later this week. And then in June, we'll have the RC rig returning to complete our gold drilling over our Sterling prospect. In the US, we've got three projects that we hope to be on the ground in US summer to be drilling those. Copper project, we're continuing to advance the in situ recovery, so looking at our hydrometallurgical work in particular. And we have interest in EnviroCopper, who have the Kapunda project. And this one, we're currently doing our push-pull test. We've completed the bromine or tracer side of things. And in the next week or so, we'll be moving forward with lixiviant trials and then moving into the salt test, which is really the last stage or feasibility stage of that project. And last but not least, our Molly Hill project is poised, if you like, to move into development phase. Due to the time constraints, I'm really just going to focus today on our Ragged Range project and our uranium projects. If you'd like to know more, please come to the booth, or I have uploaded a full copy of the presentation, including the other projects, on the ASX as well as the AIM market. So moving to Ragged Range over in WA, this is in the Pilbara, so a granite greenstone terrain. I think in the next 5 years, we're going to see huge discoveries here. We already have, you know, world-class deposits, but that's just going to increase with more people getting on the ground. And I feel very, you know, optimistic we've got in there at the right time. You can see where we're located, just down here in the greenstone belt. We've got great neighbours, large gold resources. So Calidus just to the north, moving into production, over 1.2 million ounces. We obviously have De Grey's Hemi project, 9 million ounces in the, you know, close jurisdiction. So really favourable for the gold. And then lithium, we have two of the world-class spodumene hard rock lithium deposits in the Pilbara, so Wodgina and Pilgangoora. So again, the right jurisdiction for lithium exploration. So just on the tenement or tenure side of things, we've defined a 13 kilometre gold corridor through streams and soil, so up to, you know, 2.2 grams per tonne. So these are robust geochem anomalies, but they sit on a very key regional structure, so a thrust faulted contact between the mafics and ultramafics. And the mineralisation in the Pilbara, particularly the gold mineralisation, is really structurally controlled. So it's understanding your structures more so than your lithological contacts. But this one we're working through, and as I mentioned, we anticipate being back on the ground with our RC program in the next month. In the northeast, we have some historic copper gold workings, and following up them up in due course, and a nickel gossan to the south. So quite a lot happening in our tenure. We have 100% control of that tenement, greenstone belt, as well as covering some of the split rock super suite, the granites to the north. A very busy map, but when it comes to lithium prospectivity, the key here is the association with the split rock super suite. So these are literally the little red blobs located around the area. This one is in particular where you have Wodgina, Pilgangoora, and you can see the lithium deposits of the little blue triangles. Ragged Range sits over here, and no one's followed up that area for lithium. So we'll be the first company to really be exploring for the enriched pegmatites in that area. It's not actually the split rock super suite that you're exploring on. It's actually where the pegmatites swarm out from that. So we're targeting the favourable 5 to 10 kilometre halo around the split rock super suite into the ultramafics. And this seems to be a very favourable lithological unit to for the deposition of the enriched pegmatites. So that's our key sort of target area. There has been mapped pegmatites in the middle here, so getting on the ground, following up those to see if they're enriched in the, you know, lithium, cesium and tantalum, as well as some structural areas over here as well as here. So there's four areas in particular that we're following up for the lithium prospectivity. And we should have assays back from the lab and news flow in the coming weeks on that work. On the nickel side of things, we've identified a nickel gossan. This was originally mapped by the Geological Survey, and then in recent time we've gone in and mapped that. It extends over a kilometre, 100 metres wide, and most importantly, it's in the Kamardiites and sits on the basal contact with the felsic volcanics. So this is really important for nickel sulphide deposition. So we anticipate being on the ground doing the fixed loop EM survey, as I've mentioned, and the objective of this is to identify conductive bodies at depth, which may well, potentially are nickel sulfide mineralisation. So, and then we'll follow those up with RC drilling program. As mentioned, the Stirling Prospect, which is a 13 kilometre gold corridor, we commenced an RC program at the end of last year. Unfortunately, we had some technical issues, rig breakdown, difficult to get parts, etc. So look, we canned the project, the drilling program, and we'll be up back and running in June. We've just secured the drill rig. And not only following that original program, but adding from the information that we learnt from the few holes we did complete, and really targeting the sericite, pyrite and fuchsite alteration and key structural targets, along with a robust geochemistry. So as mentioned, we'll be on the ground in June with our RC program. So moving over into the US and our uranium vanadium project. I think, as most of you are aware, we've got the geopolitical situation. We know that the US Senate is looking at sanctioning their imports from Russia. They currently import about 20% of their uranium for their over 100 reactors. So they are serious about getting a domestic supply of their uranium. They're also serious about dropping their carbon emissions, and so uranium is hitting that green energy space. So again, having assets in the US is very favourable at the moment. The projects sit on the Utah-Colorado border in the Uravan mineral belt. So Uravan literally is uranium vanadium. This is a very historic province. It's produced over 85 million pounds of uranium, 660 million pounds of vanadium, so a very enriched province to be exploring in. Good infrastructure, including the White Mesa processing facility down to the south, and that would be our objective, is to move the project forward and then toll treat through an existing processing facility. Our focus initially is on the Wedding Bells, or the Colorado side of things. It's sandstone-hosted salt wash style mineralisation, essentially named after the host unit that the mineralisation sits in. It's very high grade, and we've identified through sampling, uranium up to 1.25%, vanadium up to 3.5%. This is quite critical when you think of a lot of uranium deposits, they're sort of 0.05%. So these are exceptionally high grade targets that we're exploring for. So the mineralisation are stacked sandstone sequences. They're rather tabular, but they extend laterally in a long strike over metres to kilometres. So we're targeting areas along strike of historic workings. The mineralisation forms these halos. So you get the uranium and the vanadium forming together, but you also get an enriched halo around that. And you can just see in these images, particularly the last one, you can see you get the uranium zone, but the much wider vanadium, and they form stacked sequences in the sandstone stratigraphy. The uranium is in uraninite, colphonite, as well as carnotite, and the vanadium is in montrosite and alumina silicates. So our program is to drill three of these areas, Rimrock, Groundhog. As mentioned, they're both a long strike of historic workings, so following up, targeting those existing stratigraphic units. And then Section 23 is one that's quite interesting, because we're the first company to have access into this area. It was held by the federal government, their Bureau of Nuclear Energy. So we're the first company to go in and test this area. We know we've got the favourable stratigraphy, so really excited about getting on there, and very optimistic about intersecting uranium and hopefully some economic grades and widths. The drilling, the target horizons are only 15 metres below surface, so it's very shallow drilling, so less than 100 metre deep holes. So the plan at the moment is to be on the ground in the US summer. I'm heading over there in June to finalise the drilling and make sure all the logistics and everything are signed off, ready to commence drilling in late June, July. So looking forward to getting on the ground there and really driving this project forward. So just next steps. So exploring for high value commodities, very favourable jurisdictions to be working in, there's no sovereign risk. News all year round, so with the diverse portfolio that we have, we can be continuously exploring. So also a strong pipeline of targets working through, well-funded, and again, strong board and management. So just quickly, the news flow coming up, we'll have lithium results coming through to the market. We'll be on the ground with our nickel fixed loop EM survey, and then also the RC drill rig will arrive ready for drilling our Stirling prospect and hopefully below the nickel Gossan. So quite a lot of news from the Ragged Range project. And then most importantly, I think, or from an excited, you know, geologist point of view, is being on the ground in the US. So following up on our Colorado Wedding Bell project in June, July. So there should be some exciting news flow coming out from that project. So thank you all very much. Are we doing questions?
We've got about 10 seconds left.
Oh.
So
booth 94, if you want to come and chat and talk about the projects.
Yeah, for sure. And there is quite a bit more detail in that deck on the that's gone out through the ASX channels. So THR, if you want to look it up and read a bit more. Moving on, we're now going to hear from E79 Gold Mines and Mr. Ned Summerhayes. E79 Gold Mines is actively exploring two large underexplored land holdings within highly endowed gold provinces in Western Australia. CEO Ned Summerhayes will share an update on the projects with us all right now. So welcome.
Thank you, Ben, and thank you to all the event organisers for allowing E79 to speak. As Ben said, we are an active gold explorer in the West Australian area. We've got two gold projects in well-endowed regions, and we'll go through those projects now. Just have a standard disclaimer here. So really, the company overview is we have good management with a track record of exploration success. We have two sizable projects in world-class greenstone belts. We have a strategy of active exploration. We like to do a lot of drilling. That's where you find the deposits. And the board has a history of delivering value for their shareholders through discovery. So on the left, you can see the board of directors led by Chris Cairns, Deborah Lord and Peter Ironside are also on the board. So Chris and Peter were part of Integra Mining. They had a lot of success, sold to Silver Lake. They're now with Staveley Minerals, and now this is their return back to the goldfields. On the right, you can see a snapshot of our corporate information. And probably most importantly is just we have 7.2 million in cash. So we're fully funded for our next couple of drilling campaigns. So as mentioned earlier, we're a WA focused gold explorer. We're in the greenfields exploration side of things. We have two projects. We have a large project in the Laverton tectonic zone. This is a hugely prolific gold belt. Our second project is in the Murchison region, and that the Murchison goldfields are another large prolific gold area. So focusing now on the Laverton South project, the image that you can see on the right in the grey is the Laverton tectonic zone. So this is a large 250 kilometre structural zone with some world-class deposits within it. The table on the left, it's a little bit hard to see at this scale, but it's just outlining a few of those deposits. So you have the world-class Granny Smith, Wallaby and Sunrise Dam deposits. Now they're clustered in an area south of Laverton, around the central to northern part of the Laverton tectonic zone. That part of the zone has been very well explored and had some wonderful exploration success. E79's projects are in the southern part of that belt. Now, while the southern part of that belt has been less explored, there has been some exploration success in the last 5 to 10 years with 2 million ounce discoveries. So Breaker discovered Bombora, and then more recently Ramelius Resources have the Rebecca deposit. So within this Laverton South project, E79 has the Lake Yindarna project, which is 100% controlled by us. And we have a joint venture with St Barbara in the Pingin area. So with the Lake Yindarna project, we really have a great exploration ground here. Historically, the area was mapped as a granite, and this discouraged some of the exploration in the area. There's only 65 drill holes on this tenement in over 200 square kilometres, and large areas of that are unexplored. Within those 65 drill holes, half of them were not assayed for gold or gold pathfinder elements. What really drew E79 into this area is, while it had been mapped at a granite, as a granite, when you looked at the regional magnetics, we could start seeing a potential greenstone sitting in there. Some of the historic drilling that was done, while not assayed for gold, showed greenstone stratigraphy. So we knew that there were some greenstones in there hiding out amongst the granite. The real kicker for us, though, was when the company did a gravity survey, and you could see really the scale of the greenstone there, which runs for about 25 kilometres through the tenement package. As well as outlining the greenstone, it also outlined a couple of intrusions within that greenstone, which just form more targets for us to test. By unearthing this greenstone, we've effectively created a new search space within the region, and John Hronsky and history tells us that the bigger deposits are usually found early in the new search space because they have the largest signatures. We also, in the area, in the Laverton South project, we have a joint venture with St Barbara. We have 80% and St Barbara have 20%. Together with Lake Yindarna means we have the north and south strike extensions of the Rebecca deposit, the million ounce Rebecca deposit. The St Barbara JV itself straddles the Anglo-Saxon deposits, and further to the north is the historic Patricia open pits. So while we understand some of the larger deposits in the region, you can see here a map of the smaller scale mining, and you can see some very large trends. So the Egidina trend is over 15 kilometres of historic workings, and the Pingin trend is over 11 kilometres of historic workings. And they both run in and through the tenement package. One thing that we liked about having the JV is it had had multiple stages of historic exploration, and this allowed the previous owners, St Barbara, to run a very comprehensive targeting program, which came up with 4 high priority targets. So of those 4, E79 have drilled 2 of those. We've started getting some assays trickling back from the lab, but like everyone else, we're finding some slower than anticipated turnaround times. Target 1 is a 10 kilometre long structural zone, a stratigraphic target. The historic work on there shows that there's anomalies throughout that target, and it mostly has not been followed up. Target 3 is to the north of that, and is a northern extension of that stratigraphic zone. What we really like about this is, off our tenement and drilled in 2011 was Kerguelen's Gift, which had 33 metres at 3.1 grams per tonne. So we know that this stratigraphy has the potential to host thick, high-grade mineralisation. And this was the first area that E79 drilled shortly after listing last year. So we drilled about 7,000 metres here. And what we found was our best results sat on a subtle gravity high, which was at a contact between the granite and the greenstone. We extended the known mineralisation from 600 metres long to over 1,500 metres long. And within that broad contact zone, we identified dolerite and black shales. We've only had about 50% of the drilling returned back from the lab, and looking forward to the other 50%. Target 4 was the second area that E79 drilled. We drilled about 8,000 metres of air core early this year. The target itself was in some historic drilling. E79 did some ground gravity work and showed that it was on the western edge of this gravity low, which is a felsic intrusion. And so, yeah, the 8,000 metres went to testing a couple of targets within there. These assays are still at the lab. Oops, sorry. In terms of our neighbours, as mentioned before, we're close to the Remelius Resources Rebecca deposit and the Breaker Resources, which is now over 1.5 million ounces. They're both within 20 kilometres of our tenement package. Carosue Dam's probably the next biggest one and the biggest one in the region. They put out a announcement this morning with 4 million ounce of resource there, and St Barbara have been active in the area for a long time. We have a drill rig coming back in about a month, and it'll be focused on our Laverton South projects. Our second project is up in the Murchison, another great mineral province, over 30 million ounces of endowment within the terrain there. We've got about 50 kilometres of the Big Bell Shear and its associated structures. So the Big Bell deposit is the elephant in that part of the world. And so we're very lucky to get an underexplored part of that to have a search with. So in that region, it has had some historic exploration. BHP and Newcrest were up there. They did all the right things, their soil sampling, their follow-up drilling. They found some anomalism over several kilometres, but then they left the area and it hasn't had a lot of work done since then. One of the issues up there is the hard pan, which makes traditional soil sampling difficult to see and representative of what's underneath the hard pan. So the CSIRO have been working at developing some new techniques. We've taken the samples, which are at the lab at the moment, and we're hoping that'll really see through that hard pan and allow us to really target the exploration. As well as using that technique, we recently did a gravity survey up there. It quite well defined the Big Bell Shear, which moves around in that region, and the associated greenstone belt to the west. Some new targets were developed, and there's a nice mafic intrusion in the middle, which is extended at depth, which you can see through there. So it's a bit more extensive than we first thought. So there are our two projects. We've done some early stage drilling at Lake Indana. We're going to do some follow-up drilling starting in a month. We're trialling a new technique with the soils by CSIRO in the Murchison. And then with positive results, we hope to get the drill rig up there. So in summary, we just, we have management with a track record of success. We have some nice land in prolific greenstone belts, which are underexplored. We have a strategy of doing a lot of drilling and using some new techniques. And the board has a history of delivering for the shareholders. So thank you all very much for listening. We are at booth number 9. So if anyone would like any further information, please come forward.
No, you did really well. Thank you. So E79, if you want to go check it out, and they're outside. And again, another quite large presentation online if you want to check it out too. Next up, we've got Elementos Limited, and Joe David, the managing director there, will be taking us through. As tin prices reach all-time highs, Elementos' strategy of becoming a significant tin producer is rapidly becoming a reality. For those here this morning, we heard a little bit about tin, and it has gone just crazy the last few years. As it develops its two world-class tin projects located in the mining-friendly jurisdictions of Spain and Tasmania, the company's flagship Oropesa tin project in Andalusia, Spain, is one of the world's few global open pit low-cost tin projects, and its Cleveland Tin Project in Tasmania contains a significant mineral resource of tin copper amenable to both open cut and underground mining. So welcome, Joe.
Just forward back and point.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here again. Just cautionary statements. This is obviously available on the ASX as well. So for those who don't know tin or haven't seen some of the earlier presentations, tin has been on a bit of a stellar run the last couple of years. This is a bit of research that was done by Rio Tinto and MIT University a couple of years ago. When it came out, people probably thought it was a little bit of an academic exercise, but certainly how the tin markets have reacted in the last couple of years certainly has proved that be quite correct. What it shows is the tin was most sensitive and I guess impacted by this electrical revolution that's currently happening around the world, and certainly outranks a number of commodities and minerals that people would much quicker reference when they're asked about battery minerals and technology minerals. Tin is used in pretty much all electronics to some degree. It is called the spice metal because it is in everything in small quantities. It is still quite a small global market, but certainly extremely important and pretty much without any substitution. Tin price, as I said, has gone on a stellar run, hit $50,000 US dollars per tonne that week when nickel went crazy, pulled back a little bit, but still extremely strong. Over $40,000 still in London and over $50,000 still in the Shanghai Exchange with quite a large arbitrage happening there. The reasons for that, firstly, the market's been in deficit for about 5 years now. And in addition to that, all known global stockpiles are pretty much a couple of days worth of supply. The US, which used to hold very large strategic stockpiles, is down to about 4,000 tonnes in the last USGS report. And certainly there are no known other strategic stockpiles there. So it is a market in absolute distress right now. Why is it in the distress? The chart on the right here shows all the global producers of tin are struggling to even maintain their current production, let alone delivering tons into what is quite a strong growth sector moving forward. China's the largest producer, hasn't been able to increase their market share or their production for about 20 years now. Indonesia's rapidly dropping off. Some tons came in from Myanmar to prop the market up in the last 10 years, but those tons already appear to be dropping off. And certainly security supply, none of the countries listed there as major producers give much of the Western manufacturers much confidence in that supply chain. So this is a new slide that's hit the, it's very fresh data, but from the International Tin Association, who are the major forecasters in the region, this shows the growing deficit in the tin market. So this has all known and forecast projects coming online there on the supply in the black, and with the demand forecast by the ITA in the yellow. The red charts show us growing from about a 30,000 tonne deficit to about 70 or 80,000 tonnes at the end of the decade. And that is in a market that's only 360,000 tonnes deep. So significant deficit coming on. And as I said, even the supply chain line there has pretty much all known tin projects and developers coming online in the next 10 years. And there's still a major, major deficit. For us, our major project is in Andalusia in the south of Spain. It's the Oropesa deposit. We picked it up a couple of years ago. It is in Andalusia, as I said, which is the province you want to be in, Spain. About 50% of Spain's mineral exports come out of Spain, and certainly some very large miners in the area as well. Being the Matza project, which Samphire just bought into, is about 60 k's away, as well as First Quantum and with the Cobre Las Cruces project and the Rio Tinto copper mine owned by Atalaya. So major projects. Since we took control of the project, we did a very large infill drill campaign, which lifted our mineral resource by 50%. It also upgraded the confidence of the deposit. 88% of our deposit now sitting in the measured and indicated category. We're taking this project through a DFS right now, the goal to produce JORC ore reserves. So having a geological confidence up in the measured and indicated is critical for us. In terms of this program, we also identified a lot of extra mineralization close to the surface with 5 million tonnes within 100 metres of surface. This is planned to be an open cut deposit. We also recently just put out an optimization study, which of the 19 million tonnes of resource, 15.5 came inside the pit shells. We've done it quite a conservative tin price of 32,500 compared to the current spot price over 40,000 and 50,000 in China. This optimization study is fully aligned with the regulatory approvals that we also just submitted. We just submitted our mining license application and our environmental impact assessment with the goal of getting issued our mining license in the next 12 to 18 months. As you can see here, we also can get a couple of extra years mine life if the tin prices hold up to currently where they are. We've got about 13 years of mine life currently in this mining schedule. As I said, we upped the scale of the project, 1.25 million tonnes mining rate. That's about a million tonnes going into the front of the process plant after ore sorting, producing about 3,300 tonnes of tin metal per year and at an 8-time strip ratio, but very handy looking economics for a tin mine there. And we said we put out some MPVs for the project using our conservative base case price for the project. We're at $292 million MPV, but obviously as you move towards the spot price in both London and Shanghai, those numbers become extremely interesting to us as a company. $86 million capex as well, very low capex for a project of this size and scale, so very exciting for us. This is just the same slide. Other thing that's really pushed us along is we got effectively what Australians would understand as a state significant project in Andalusia. Only 7 projects got accepted into their project accelerator unit, and we were one of them. The other companies being Samphire Resources, Matsa project, which is over $2 billion project, and the Atalaya Rio Tinto copper mine, which is a $1 billion market cap as well. So us as a $130-140 million company getting into this group is extremely good. A lot of support from the government, not only coordinating our regulatory submissions, but also giving us a full-time engineer and a few other things on our side of the table. So a lot of support from the government to push this project along. As I said, we are taking this project through to a DFS in this current tin market. We want to move this thing into construction and production as quick as possible. So skipping the traditional PFS, but certainly we know the scope's right, and certainly take this project through a DFS is the right approach. So we've got a lot of on-ground lab work and engineering studies happening right now to support going through that DFS for the project. When we did do our geotech holes, we did 10 geotech holes around as part of those programs. We did hit some pretty interesting tin mineralization, also some interesting zinc intercepts outside our resource. It certainly shows us some pretty high prospectivity to increase this resource as well. Although, it won't be the basis of our definitive feasibility study, but certainly some opportunities to extend that mine life as we move along. So from now on, we've got this is a schedule moving to goal to get our DFS and our approvals both done the first half of next year, moving through obviously in parallel that the project financing. We'll then take this into construction for about 18 months, and the goal is to have this thing into operation during 2025. We also have our historic project, which is our Cleveland Tin project in Tasmania. It is an old operating tin mine, ceased in about 1988. It's got a decent looking resource there. We have done some drilling there in the last few years to get that resource better defined. It does have some pretty interesting tungsten grades and resource. It's just sort of been tagged at depth as well. So certainly interesting on both those fronts for us. It is an old operating mine. You see, we've got 500 metres of historic underground workings, about 150 metres up from the portal entry, 350 metres down. As I said, there's a lot of resource that hasn't been mined through there that we'd plan on mining. But we have also identified some interesting mineralisation along strike and within the existing resource. We currently have the drill rig spinning down there, including today. We're doing our 4th out of 5 holes, certainly to try to identify some of that extra mineral mineralisation. And obviously, if we hit that mineralisation, we'll be taking that through to get the drill rigs down there, resource it up, take this thing through some of the formal studies and get a second project underway as well. As for the corporate side, we're about 130, 140 million market cap. We have $7 million worth of cash thanks to the exercising of options that completed in April. We have a good share register. Our non-exec chairman, Andy Gregg, is our largest shareholder at 12.5%. And as a number of other shareholders listed there on that list, but very good support from our current shareholders. No debt and an EV of about 130 million. Here's our board. As I said, Andy, it's great support of the company, both financially as a shareholder. Also, he ran Bechtel Metals and Mining for 15 years and was an employee for 35 years. So deep knowledge and interest in the delivery of major projects. Talks about $500 billion worth of projects over his career. Brett Smith, non-executive director, currently the executive director of Australia's largest tin company, Metals X. Calvin Tracy and Corey Nolan also as Ned's there as well. Corey's presenting after me, so I won't talk too much about him for Platina Resources. And that's it. Thank you very much. Thank you, guys.
Questions on tin, Spain, Tasmania, anything that they want to bring up?
That's done a good job.
You've done a great job, I think. Awesome. Yeah. You've got a booth outside or?
I do. I cannot tell you which number it is.
That's all right.
Look for the Elementos booth.
Is it branded yellow?
Branded yellow, exact same colour. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you very
Cheers,
much.
Cheers, guys. Thank you.
As Joe said, we've got one of his compatriots up next. So Corey Nolan's coming up to talk about Platina Resources. Platina is a gold-focused explorer targeting deposits in the world-class Yilgarn, Creighton and Ashburton Basin regions of Western Australia. The company also holds the high-grade Platina Scandium project in New South Wales and offers further upside through its investments in several precious base and specialty metal projects. So welcome. No, come on, you got to. Are you going to jump up? Easy.
Thank you.
No worries. Forward, back, and point. No worries.
Awesome. Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the conference. It's good to be here to talk about Platina, which is nearly completed on a plan to get drilling soon. So the next 6 months is going to be a very exciting period for Platina. So Platina is a 23 million market cap company. We've got three projects in Western Australia, all 100% owned. Two are granted, and we're just waiting for our Mount Naira project to be granted. And we also own a very high grade resource or reserve of scandium in New South Wales. Platina's historically invested over $16 million in that project, and we're working on a strategy to unlock that value of that project for our shareholders. Platina, I guess this makes us a little unique compared to most exploration companies. We've been through an active process of divesting some of our non-core assets in the last few years. And as such, we've got a portfolio of investments valued at about $7.5 million in listed entities. They're all in companies with projects that we believe have significant upside. And any in particular, our biggest investment, which is in Major Precious Metals, we've got 49 million shares in that company. They've just recently completed an 8,500 meter drilling program. They've got one of the world's certainly one of the world's largest palladium deposits outside of Russia and South Africa in Greenland. And they're just in the process of starting to release some of those results to the market. And they'll be looking to do a big upgrade of that resource once all those results have been announced to the market. So we'd be looking for some upside out of that investment that we have. So our key share price drivers is pretty simple. We're going to start drilling two of our projects fairly soon. we expect a lot of upside in our stock price if we have success from those programs. We'll be selling our investments and realizing the cash and putting that back into our West Australian gold exploration. And that'll give us the ability of keeping our share capital structure very tight and also unlocking the value of our Scandium project. So our focus is on Western Australia. We have three projects, two granted, and we're looking to drill both of those projects fairly shortly. The Challa project is in the Yilgarn. I think everybody's pretty aware that that's a world-class province, excellent infrastructure, very sophisticated drilling capabilities, you know, great place to do exploration. And we also have the Xanadu project, which is in the Ashburton Basin, probably a little less known to people. There are a number of multi-million ounce deposits in the Ashburton. It flanks the Pilbara Craton, which is obviously a hotspot destination, given the success that we're seeing with Hemi and De Grey. And we really believe that the Ashburton is pretty underexplored, and we have a very large tenement package there that we're looking to take on. We've just appointed Rowan Deshpande as our exploration manager. Rowan's got over 15 years experience in the industry. In fact, he just spent the last 4 years working for De Grey. He was part of the discovery team on Hemi and has a huge amount of experience drilling out projects. I think at one point in time, I think he said he had 14 drill rigs going that he was responsible for. So he should be able to cover our projects pretty well. And Rowan will also take a really active role in helping us identify new opportunities to grow our portfolio. Rowan's actually here, and you can come meet him at our booth. So our two projects in WA, Xanadu Gold Project. It's located 38 kilometres from Paraburdoo. So we can easily drive in and out of Paraburdoo each day. There's a regular number of flights from Perth to Paraburdoo each day. So that just helps keep our cost structures down. We've got a very large tenant package. It's 560 kilometres squared. We've got about 60 kilometres of a major fault zone and its splays. And we're only 7 kilometres away from the Kalamazoo's Mount Olympus deposit. It's a 2 million ounce endowment. They've mined about 350,000 ounces there, and they have a current refractory resource of about 1.65 million ounces. So it's always good to explore where there's other major deposits. So the Xanadu projects had quite a lot of historical exploration. There's been quite a lot of surface sampling work done. There's been some geophysics, and there's been quite a lot of it drilling. So we've inherited all of this information. But we believe that the project hasn't been very systematically explored. A lot of the work was focused on identifying very shallow oxide resources near surface for a heap leach operation that was developed there. You can see that there's two stockpiles there. One was about 200,000 tonnes at 1.8 grams, and then there was another major stockpile there as well. And you can see a small photo of the open cut that they developed. So during that drilling, there was some very good large width and economic grade intercepts in gold. And there was a couple of deeper holes that have been drilled here, but a lot more deeper work needs to be done. So we really like the Xanadu project. It's on a major fault zone. It's got the neurology with the nearby Mount Olympus deposit. There's widespread gold mineralization through a very large 10 kilometer long hydrothermal alteration zone. And we've got the real favorable rocks here for the discovery of a major ore body. So this diagram on the right, it's a little busy, but it just shows you some of the historical drilling intersections in there. Some really good stuff in there that we can work with. This is the 10 kilometre strike extent. It's up in the northwestern zone. So we're really only touching a very small part of this tenement package that we have. We recently completed a very systematic geophysics program and have got what we believe is a better understanding of the deeper potential in this project. So we've got two targets here. We're targeting the oxide mineralization that's been mined before, and then we're really looking to try and identify the source of that that oxide mineralization. Very deeply weathered here, it goes down to about 80 meters, so that's why we had to sort of rely on the geophysics to get a better understanding of those basement rock structures. But we're going to come back through there. We've got some initial planned drill holes there. We're going to look to do about 4,000 meters of RC drilling there as soon as we can get a cultural heritage signed off. So hopefully in the next couple of months, we'll be on the ground here drilling. We also have the Challa project. It's in the Yilgarn Craton. It's nestled between Mount Magnet, UME and Sandstone. It's a prolific gold producing region. We're sort of centered in the middle of that. A large part of our tenements are undercover here, so we've had to really rely on some different techniques for trying to look under the cover and identify some targets here. The other interesting thing about this area, given that the amount of gold produced in this area, is that there's not a single drill hole on our tenement package. We've got nearly 300 square kilometers of ground here, so it's very attractive. We've got two primary targets here. We've got our Challa West tenement. It's runs along the Challa fault zone. We believe that we've got some greenstone rocks undercover here. Some large zones of hydrothermal alteration come up through the geophysics. And as I mentioned before, we've been relying on using soil sampling. So we've done over nearly 4,000 soil samples across this package. And our plan is to come back and use some air core drilling to drill through to the basement rocks so that we can try and identify follow-up anomalies for deeper drilling in the future. And we've also got our Challa East tenement. There are some outcropping rocks up in the northeast of this package. We know that the prospectors have found a lot of gold nuggets just off the edges of our tenements here. This is also a quartz and gold sample from near our area as well. We have done some rock chip sampling on our own tenements. We've had up to 6 grams per ton gold in some of our rock chips. So we think this is another really exciting area that definitely warrants drilling. This is our Mount Nairo project. It's in the Western Yilgarn Craton. We're about 300 kilometers north of the Chalice's Julmar deposit. We believe that we have a very similar structure and rock type that's analogous to that Julmar nickel PGE discovery. Once that tenement is granted, we'll be looking forward to sort of getting on the ground there and taking a very similar approach to what others are taking in that basin and doing geophysics and soil sampling to identify targets. Hopefully we get this tenement granted fairly soon. So our Scandium project, we've invested $16 million in this project. It's got 48,000 meters of drilling. We completed a DFS here in 2018 for a fairly low capital. It generates a very high internal rate of return. One of the challenges with the Scandium industry is that the market's quite small. So we've been working on a number of strategies on how we can diversify our revenue and by going downstream further and capturing more of the value chain through our master alloy test work, which is proving to be very successful. In parallel with that, we've been working on completing our permitting for the project and talking to a number of interested parties on how we can unlock the value of this project and generate a return for our shareholders. Just in terms of how that Scandium project fits with Patina, at a 23 million market cap, we have our near $10 million portfolio of cash and investments. Plus we've got our gold portfolio in Western Australia. But you could compare that to say an Imperial Mining or a Scandium International. They're pure play Scandium companies. They have either equal or higher market capitalizations to Platina. And if you were to then compare it to, say, nickel cobalt scandium plays, which have significantly higher market caps, you can see that Platina looks like it's a very undervalued company. So just to wrap up, our share price catalysts in the near term, drilling our Xanadu and Chala projects and the news flow that comes from that. Hopefully we'll get our Mount Naira prospect granted and we can get on the ground and start producing some results there. We're actively looking to build our portfolio in WA. So we're looking at new opportunities and how we can add value to the company. Hopefully we'll have a path forward to unlock the value of our scandium project and then using the our investments, selling them, using the cash proceeds to fund our exploration in Western Australia without diluting our already tight share capital. Thank you very much.
Are you outside in a booth?
Yes.
Yep, perfect. Great. Go say hi. So we've got two more presentations this afternoon before wrapping up in this room. Also just a reminder, just a hello to everyone online. If you want to see any of these again, I think they're recorded and uploaded individually about an hour after the presentation as well. So next up, we've got Tesoro Resources, who currently hold one of the largest and most prospective gold properties in Chile and is strategically positioned with established infrastructure and surrounded by mines. Zeph Reeves, co-founder and managing director, will provide an update of the recently announced exceptional drilling results, newly discovered Ternura analogs, and upcoming mineral resource upgrade.
So thank you very much.
Cheers, thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Forward back.
Right, yeah. Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks for taking the time to come and listen to the Tesoro story and for RIU for giving us the opportunity to present again. So Tesoro has just changed its name. We're now Tesoro Gold, and we think that better reflects the asset that we've got in Chile. It's a gold-only project located in a strategic location on the coast, close to port and infrastructure. We've got a maiden resource. We've just completed 100,000 metres of drilling, and we're going to update that resource in the near future. And a single asset company. Our usual disclaimer. So this photo here shows the Ternura gold deposit, which is where we focused majority of our drill meters into over the last 2 years. That's where a majority of that 100,000 meters has gone. That's looking down to the south from the top, looking over the Ternura deposit. Ternura is an outcropping ore body. There's a ridge line in the foreground there, which is essentially completely mineralized with gold. It dips back to the east to the left-hand side of that photo. And pretty much the more drilling we've done into this, the more gold we're finding, and it's certainly starting to demonstrate some serious scale. So here's a location map of where the project is. So it's about 800 kilometres north of Santiago, so it's very easy to get to. So now it's a plane flight from Santiago up to Copiapó, which is the city down in the south there. Just here. Our team uses Caldera as a base, and it's a 50-minute drive straight up the Pan American Highway and into the project, and that's the Ternura deposit where that orange diamond is. So you can see all the operations that are in this region. It's historically a copper mining region. There's essentially three belts of rocks here. There's the belt that we're in, which is what we now term the El Zorro trend. We're the first company that's found significant gold mineralization of this style in this belt. To the east of us is the IOCG trend, so world-class mines such as Lundin Mining's Candelaria mine and Manto Verde, which is run by Mitsubishi. Further to the east, along the Atacama Fault System, there's porphyry and epithermal gold deposits, such as Codelco's Inca de Oro mine. And then further up into the Andes, we're seeing the much younger, big porphyry and epithermal deposits, such as the recently permitted Goldfield Solaris Norte mine. So
this region's got a track record of a significant copper producer, significant gold producer. Copiapó is a mining city. It's like a big Kalgoorlie, so all the mining services are there. We have power, water from the ocean, so all of our network's been done in seawater. Low altitude, can work there all year round and no imposition on anything that we need to do. We've defined an initial gold resource, which was announced in July last year, of 660,000 ounces. We've since drilled another 55,000 metres of drilling into the deposit since then, and expecting a major resource upgrade in the near future. And our preliminary network and other studies that we've done are indicating that this has got a pretty good chance of getting up to being a future gold mine. So this is what the deposit looks like looking back to the north. So Ternera is that ridge line there again, sticking out of the ground. When we got on site, Ternera was the only known occurrence of gold on this property. We've since found gold at Drone Hill. Initial drilling has had positive results there. We found gold at Toro Blanco, again, initial drilling with positive results and potential northern extensions. Toro Gordo is a high grade vein system, which we've discovered. That's had drilling in it with results up to 60 grams a tonne. And Ternera East sits in the hanging wall of the main Ternera deposit. Again, that's been drilled. That needs more drilling to get that into resource, but we're pretty optimistic that there will be some more gold resources coming out of that. Ternera outcrops, we've drilled it down to 500 metres deep. It's over 1.2 kilometres long. It's up to 750 metres wide. And there's three main high grade zones that sit within the deposit that offer some pretty compelling opportunities for open pit mining. One key point on this deposit is the metallurgy is exceptional. So I haven't seen met like this in a gold deposit that I've ever worked on. So at a very coarse grind size of 150 microns, recovers up to 94.5% gold with quite a short leach time in cyanide, but more importantly, high gravity recoveries, even at low grades. So that allows us to pull the head grade down. So just about everything with gold in it in this deposit is going to go through a mill. So this isn't a complicated project. It's very simple. It's a bulk mining, open pit with very simple metallurgy, close to infrastructure. So this diagram is a view of the existing optimised pit at an $1,800 gold price. And those little red discs on that diagram are drill hits of greater than 1 gram per tonne that have been drilled since that initial resource was announced back in July. So we've got major extensions to the west. We've got high grade deep zones underneath that pit. And this is the new Ternera East zone out here. Also within that pit, we've essentially filled that up with gold mineralisation now. So areas within that existing resource, which either didn't make it to resource or were quite narrow zones, have now bulked out in some pretty decent zones. And essentially we're converting waste to ore with the more drilling we do. So this is behaving really well. The more data that we get from drilling, the more gold we're adding into that existing pit shell. So this map is a geology map of the Ternera deposit. So Ternera occurs in a suite of intrusive rocks, which are the pink colours on this map. They've been hit by faults, which have introduced the gold-bearing fluids and deposited the gold. So on that map, the green dots are the drilled collars that were used in the original resource estimate. It was 145 odd holes. We've since drilled another 150 holes into the deposit, another 55,000 metres of drilling there shown as the red dots. And some of those drill results that we've announced since that resource was calculated have been some of probably the best results that we've seen out of the deposit. And these are fairly typical of what you see out of Ternera, such as 7 metres at 66.1 grams contained within a wider intercept of 63.9 at 7.6, 10.6 at 14.34, contained within 63.6 at 2.89. So that's typical of what we see. We drill through these fault zones, the grade really picks up. These are good high-grade continuous zones that are strike extensive, well over 750 metres long. There's three main ones that we've delineated from our drilling. They hang together really well in 3D. They're continuous, they're wide, and they're predictable. And they're going to obviously offer a really nice high-grade zones for us to kick off mining. They also outcrop, and we've drilled them down to 500 metres deep. You'll also see on this map, there's a couple of drill collars that are quite wide spaced down in the south here. That's a 500 metre scale bar. So this is quite a big scale, but this hole here in particular had a, for the scheme of things for Tenera, a modest drill intercept of about 10 metres at 1.5 grams. But that's 300 metres south of any other drilling that we've done, and shows that that system is well and truly open to the south. So we've got a lot of low hanging fruit to add into future resource upgrades with additional drilling. So we're pretty keen to get back drilling, which we aim to do towards the end of this month, early June. So here's a few sections showing some of the hits that we've had since that resource was announced. So on these sections, the background orange colour is the resource outline above 0.3 of a gram. And a majority of these drill hits, particularly the highlighted pink ones, are hits outside of that resource or thickening that resource area up. This is that 63 metres at 7.6 sitting in there. We've drilled 24 holes or 25 holes now that have intercepted bigger than 100 grams per metre intercepts. So pretty phenomenal drill rate. The more we drill, the more gold resource we're adding into this deposit. As you can see, the scale on that is 100, so that's 750 metres of more or less continuous mineralisation now. So we're expecting this to really bulk out and fill up these, particularly these shallow areas, and becomes quite a compelling open pit mining opportunity. Again, some more examples of drilling since that initial resource was announced. You can see what some of this drilling's done. It's joining up a lot of these mineralized zones. So again, it's nice, big, wide mineralized zones, very good for open pit mining. I've recently just returned from Chile, finally got back over there after having travel restrictions due to COVID, and spent the month of April in Chile. And I think from the geologist's point of view and the upside for this project, this was the really exciting part. I got to spend quite a bit of time with our team on the ground and walk quite a bit of the areas that they've been mapping. And we've got Tenera down in this area down here, and it occurs as a dike swarm of these intrusive rocks. Tenera is 1.3 kilometres long. Those rocks have been mapped now. Up in this area, there's a new dike swarm that we've discovered, another one here and another one here. This one here is nearly 5 kilometres long. It's got anomalous gold wherever those intrusive rocks are. We're not soil sampling, we're not using geophysics. This is outcropping rock with gold in it sticking out of the ground that's never been discovered before. So what our team's doing now is doing detailed work over each of these zones to find the best parts that we'd like to go and drill. And we're aiming to get on the ground there probably during June, once we get our final assays back, to go and drill these areas. Some of the channel sampling results that we've had out of these areas, particularly down in the southern part of this one, 3 metres at 101 grams sticking out of the ground. A metre at 12.7 sticking out of the ground. 1.2 at 12.7 sticking out of the ground. So these are potentially outcropping ore bodies that have been undiscovered till now. So what does all that mean? This is a new gold district in Chile. This is an intrusive related gold system. They've never been found before in Chile. We're the first company that's found one of these. And generally, once you have one deposit in these systems, you see multiple clusters. So we're very optimistic there's another one, possibly two Teneras in this. So what have we got planned to unlock all of this and create more value for our shareholders? An updated mineral resource that's more or less imminent. We've halted our drilling for now. We've got 100,000 metres of drilling to go and work on to provide that mineral resource update. I think that'll start to demonstrate the true potential and true scale of not only Tanera, but our Zorro as a project. We're able to then replicate what Tanera is in some of those new areas. We'll get back on the ground towards the end of this month and start to drill some of those extensions as well. And the exciting part that our team's aching to do is to drill some of these new targets. The excitement that I hear from the team, actually seeing them face to face, walking this outcropping gold system is really encouraging. And the more work they do, the more and more excited they get about it. And they think that Tanera could perhaps only be the edge of this system, and there's a lot more to come. So we're pretty excited about the future there. Following the back of that resource update, we'll also start to get some numbers out into the market around what a future mine may look like in this part of the world. And that'll be done via a scoping study, start to show some of the costs. Obviously, we've got major benefits with the location. You know, there's no better place in the world to build a gold mine than where El Zorro is located, with port, power, water, low altitude and easy access all year round. So we think it's going to be quite an exciting 6 to 12 months for the company. There's a lot of upside in this project to come with an already defined resource sitting in the middle of it. So thanks for taking the time to listen, and hopefully you can follow the Tesoro journey. We've got a booth, so come and have a chat if you have time. Thank you.
I can just imagine being a geo and literally finding gold sticking out of the ground. I imagine they are quite excited to go and drill those targets. Coming up as our final presentation for this afternoon here, we've got Latin Resources, who are developing minerals to provide the planet with environmentally sustainable products. Please join me in welcoming Managing Director Chris Gale, who's going to provide an update on the company's Salinas Lithium project in Brazil and its Halloysite Kaolin project in Western Australia. Perfect, thank you.
Round us out.
Thank you.
Forward, back, and
forward.
You're the last one, so no timer.
No problems. Thanks, everyone, for coming along this afternoon. It's good to be back in Sydney and with no mask. It's wonderful. Disclaimer. So Latin Resources has been operating in South America now for 12 years. We have a market cap of $258 million, cash of $39 million, enterprise value of $219 million. The top 50 control around 40-odd% of the company. So it's very tightly held. We recently raised $35 million a couple of weeks ago. Three funds from the US, green funds, fundamentally came into the company with $29 million of that $35 million. So I think we are actually doing some pretty good things from the environmental side with the company. You've probably all, those who are in lithium, have probably all seen this slide a number of times. It's been shown, I suppose, in the last three conferences I've been at least 20 times, but this is a very, very real slide that actually tells us what's about to happen to this globe, this planet, in respect of electric vehicles and also electric storage. It's very real, it's going to happen, no one's going to stop it. And we're going to see a massive undersupply of lithium and a massive over-demand for lithium. Hence, the prices have gone from around $5,000 a tonne for lithium carbonate to $58,000 a tonne over the last 12 months. Spodumene's gone from $600 a tonne to $3,000 a tonne, so up 4 to 5 times. This is another reason why vehicle growth, I just mentioned, hydroxide needs spodumene. So lithium hydroxide in Argentina, Chile, you have lithium carbonate being developed in those mines, in the brines and the clays. Lithium hydroxide is produced fundamentally from spodumene. So in Western Australia, my home state, we produce most of the world's hard rock spodumene, but there happens to be some very good and real spodumene that we've discovered Hence the reason why our market cap went from $50 to $250 million in a month after our discovery of our lithium in Brazil. So hydroxide needs spodumene, and why? Because to reduce hydroxide, it's actually 17% cheaper than producing it from a lithium brine out of Argentina or Chile. So once again, that spodumene price has climbed from $500 a ton to from $500 a ton to around about $2,500-$3,000 a ton. LAT Resources commenced its ESG project and the following the World Economic Framework on ESG policy 6 months ago. We report now on our ESG policy on a quarterly basis. And the reason why we were actually picked up on ESG governance is basically we're in the throes of producing two minerals that are very important for that carbon net zero footprint, which is lithium and copper. So I'm going to talk mainly today, mostly on our Brazil lithium project, and once again, which we just have a major discovery there. So Brazil is world's eighth largest economy. If I ask anyone, I just do this off the cuff occasionally, how many people live in Brazil? 220 million people live in Brazil. São Paulo has a city of 24 million people, the size of Australia. It's massive in mining, great mining jurisdiction. BHP, Vale, all the big miners been operating through there, iron ore, copper, nickel. But one thing they've actually missed, and one company in 2017 picked up on this, was lithium hard rock in Minas Gerais, which is one of the world's greatest mining jurisdictions. Belo Horizonte has a population of 4 million people, twice the size as Perth. It is the Perth of Brazil, if you like, the Western Australia of Brazil, but they have twice as many mining consultants operating out of Belo than Perth does. So it's a massive mining district. So it's a very good mining district to operate in. Sigma in 2017 started exploring this particular region for lithium spodumene. They have since proven up a 48 million tonne JORC resource, the average grade of 1.38%. When they first started exploring through here, they were $50 to $70 million market cap. They're now $1.8 billion. So they've grown incredibly high. The reason for that is they've just started building their lithium plant. Obviously, they've gone through, they've got their JORC, they've got their PFS, their DFS, and that's now just started building their plant. So they've done a wonderful job of putting Brazil on the map for lithium spodumene. In 2018, someone sent me Sigma's presentation. I got our guys who were operating in Argentina, our geologists, to go on Brazil and look through. And we started pegging ground to the north of them. And we found some outstanding, well, what we did discover earlier this year when we started drilling these is outstanding lithium pegmatites, spodumene pegmatites. Some of the grades that you probably, a lot of people haven't seen in this country, because typically in Australia, we get 1 to 1.5% lithium content in our spodumene. We're sort of averaging 2 to 3%, which is incredibly high. There's one other place in Western Australia called Greenbushes, which is the largest, highest grade spodumene deposit in the world. Some of those grades are there with very similar to what we're finding here in Bananal Valley. So these are the first four holes we've put out over the last month. We've got another 6 to 8 holes to come out soon. But once again, we're getting thick intersects, grades of 2, 2.6, 3.07%. So they just keep coming through. Obviously, the market rewards good results, and that's one of the reasons we're now sitting where we are. We have three project areas, and to note, of the Sigma 45 million tonne JORC resource, they have four deposits over their project area. We have three project areas. This is the one I just showed you before, is Bananal Valley. This is the second one, which is Salinas South. We haven't started drilling this, but we will start drilling this over the next few months. And the third one, which we just started drilling, is Monte Alto. Some of these, when we go out and we explore and we do our exploration work, we We spend months out looking at the pegmatites, mapping them, sampling them, and some very high grades came back on this as well from the surface. So if you look at Bunanow Valley and the way the market rewarded us just on that one project area, we've just started drilling this again and we're going to start to see results come out of this project area over the next few months as well. So we think we can build a resource very similar to Sigma with our project areas. And it's quite exciting what we're doing now as we're expediting with that $35 million we've just raised. $20 million will be going into the drilling of this project over the next 4 or 5 months to produce our maiden JORC resource. So very exciting what we're doing. We've got another rig turning up this month. We'll have a fourth rig turn up in June. So watch this space. There's going to be a massive amount of drilling go through here. And our goal is to produce a JORC resource within the next 4 to 5 months. A little bit on Argentina now. So Argentina, this is where we have the largest land holding in Argentina for hard rock lithium spodumene. We started exploring this in 2017. We started the first lot of drilling came out with some exceptional results there as well. We actually finished that drilling and moved up into Northwest Alto. COVID hit, knocked Argentina about, so we couldn't get back on the ground. We're just getting back on the ground this month to finish off this field work. So the mapping, the sampling, and identifying the drill targets. And we plan on starting to drill this particular project with we actually have a JV partner on this. We're putting $1 million into this project to earn 50%. So we see this project also developing by the end of this year with hopefully some more good drill results there. So two great countries with two great potential lithium project areas. Our news flow and milestones over the next 6 months. Capital raising's just been completed. We've commenced drilling Monte Alto project. Salinas South will be next in June. Assay results, as you know, the market requires news to actually sustain and grow our share price. We will have lots of news coming out with our assays over the next 3 to 4 months. Test work will start in September once with part of that drilling we're doing at Bunanow Valley. Next goal, major goal for us is a JORC resource, and I'm going to show you shortly why a JORC resource is so important. A PFS, pre-feasibility study, and a DFS, which is definitive feasibility study. So there's no question that this company wants to be a producer of lithium by 2024-25, when that supply curve changes over the demand curve. We want to be in production, producing lithium spodumene, feeding lithium hydroxide plants by 2025. That's our goal. Just a little bit on this. This is quite interesting. We've got Lake Resources, Piedmont, Sigma, Liontown, all sitting along here. This is when the lithium price moved with carbonate from $5,000 to $40,000 a tonne, and spodumene moved from $500-$600 a tonne to $2,500-$3,000 a tonne. Obviously, Liontown's a standout. They're sitting there at about $3 billion market cap. Lake have done a wonderful job out of Argentina, $2 billion. But when they started getting their PFS, DFS, and obviously offtake agreements, that's when they really took off. That resources currently sits down in this area about 250 million market cap. So our goal, as I said earlier, is to actually build that JORC resource, move into PFS, and imminently, obviously, the DFS and then production. So if you wanted to look at any other company that you're looking at this conference and look at some of the fundamentals of this company are very strong. We're in the right space at the right time. Market cap sitting at 250 million. And we want to be, and Sigma, our peer project, which is, you know, 120K south of us, is sitting at 1.8 billion. So long way to go, a lot of hard work. But we hope to get there very, very quickly. Thank you very much.
Everyone, that's a wrap for this stage. It's afternoon tea time, so feel free to grab something, grab a coffee. There's drinks later on, but between now and drinks, there's another 6 companies presenting on the other stage, and we'll see you back here in the morning. Thanks, everyone. Thank you.